back, guys. The Virginia State Bar's Young Lawyers Conference puts on these programs and projects such as the Professional Development Conference on through the efforts of its volunteer members. So, you guys know what's coming next. Come on, guys. I'm going to ask you to volunteer for stuff. The YLC puts on different CLE programs on including the First Day in Practice Seminar, Immigration Law CLE, the Mental Health Law CLE, in addition to projects such as Word Match, Student Day at the State Capitol, the Swearing-In Ceremonies, the Minority Pre-Law Conference, and the Legal Handbook for Cancer Survivors. There's no registration fee to join the YLC, and you get to build your professional network across the Commonwealth. In your, the information needs to be including your registration packets. At this point, you just go online onto the YLC website and find all the information there. You can also link in Twitter, Facebook.
Google Plus.
What?
Google Plus.
Google Plus. And find out all the information that way. Or if you have any sort of questions about volunteering, Chris or I can tell you all about it. Actually, Nathan, also our new speaker, is also a former chair of the YLC, right? Yes, so he can tell you all about what a great opportunity is and how you've become one of the top litigators in the entire state by joining YLC. Well. Is that how you became where you are today, YLC, right?
Yeah,
it's
really
helpful. All right, now let's talk about Nathan, huh? All right, for the last 10 years, Nathan Veldhuis has been practicing med-mal, professional malpractice, wrongful death, defamation, and personal injury law throughout Virginia. He has extensive trial experience and has taught numerous CLEs. Nathan received his undergraduate degree from Liberty in 1999 and his law degree from George Mason in 2004. Nathan is not only a former board member of the YLC, currently serves on the Virginia Trial Lawyers Association Board of Governors as the chair of the Virginia College of Trial Advocacy on the Virginia State Bar's Litigation Section Board of Governors, where he chairs the Mid-Year Legal Seminar Committee, which will be putting on a CLE program in Madrid in November of this year. Additionally, Nathan has been elected a member of the Boyd Graves Conference and has an annual rating with Martindale Hubbard. So without further ado, Nathan on Virginia Trial Practice.
I will add, look, I mean, YLC is a great opportunity. It helped me in the most way, I think, because, you know, while being a member of the Virginia Trial Lawyers Association is helpful, certainly, that's all trial lawyers. Being a member of the YLC is lawyers who practice all kinds of things, and so you get to meet people who practice in areas where you don't practice, and I found that to be very helpful. So today, you've got your materials in front of you. I'm not really going to go through these. What I plan to do is more give you some tips, take you through the life of the trial. We only had an hour, and I wanted to ask, who has tried a jury trial in this room? Is anybody? Okay, a couple. Anybody in general district court? Again, others who've seen a trial, have watched a trial from start to finish? Okay, so I don't want to be too basic, but I also don't want to miss anything. So some of the things that I'm going to touch on are just ideas for you when you get to your next trial, some things to think about. And hopefully, this will not be like Christopher Columbus, who when he left didn't know where he was going, and when he got there didn't know where he was, and then when he got home didn't know where he'd been. I'm hopeful we can avoid that. I think that it's important at the beginning of a trial, when you're prepping for a trial, I'm not going to go through discovery and filing a complaint. Those materials are here, and Melissa was very helpful in putting these together. It's important. I'm going to begin with sort of thinking about coming up to trial and taking it through the trial. It's important at the very beginning to put together an outline of proof, and that is, what do I need to do? What do I have to show? What are the facts that I need to prove my case? And what you need to worry about initially is just proving your case in chief, which means your evidence, if you're the plaintiff, to get past a motion to strike your evidence, what do I need to do to get to that point so I can get at least to a jury? And for the defense, you want to put together the proof. What do I need to show? What do I need to poke holes in the plaintiff's case so that they do not reach that threshold? So an outline of proof is the way to start. Once you have that, then you can begin to put together how that evidence will come in. I'm going to start with General District Court, and I'm going to do that briefly, and then I'm going to move more to Circuit Court. Obviously, there are two different types of trial courts in Virginia. your small claims court, but we're not going to talk about that. There's general district court, which is jurisdiction up to $25,000 that was recently moved from 15 a couple of years ago. And then there's circuit court, which is limitless, obviously, and shares jurisdiction with general district court from $4,500 to $2,500 or $25,000. General district court, there's no jury, it's just a judge. And the beauty of general district court is if you've got a case that is a lower value, under $25,000, that the abdomen would be, it's a very quick way and a cheap way to get your case tried. Again, you can in general district court, the limit is $25,000, and there's no discovery. The only discovery that's allowable is subpoenas, subpoenas ducis tecum, which are subpoenas to the other party, to witnesses, and you're allowed to get information that way. If you're in the plaintiff's side, I would suggest you subpoena the assurance adjuster's file. You'll get resistance with that, but you can show there's a law on this that it is not protected, all protected by work product doctrine, even though you will hear that objection. You can subpoena witnesses to trial, you can subpoena, you know, other entities' files, but you can't, there's no interrogatories, there's no request for production, there's nothing like that. So use the subpoenas. That's your way to get information, get pictures and things like that of the scene, which the insurance company and the PI situation would have. Scheduling is fast, and you'll usually get a trial in a couple of months. Circuit court, you could be waiting a year. In Fairfax, they're very fast. They push it through. They won't let your case go beyond a year. But in lots of other jurisdictions, I mean, I've got some cases that have been hanging around for years, and circuit court is, that's a disadvantage of circuit court and an advantage of general district court. In general district court, you can also get the medical bills and records in through affidavits in a personal injury case, or a med mal case for that matter, but you probably wouldn't find a med mal case in general district court. Affidavits are, you don't need an expert. You don't need to bring your doctor's lot. You can have an affidavit and append the records, read the statute, and you can get those in. So it's much cheaper than hiring a doctor for $8,000 to come testify when you can get that information in through affidavits. One tip for general district court, lots of times judges will say, does anybody want to get an opening statement? Always give an opening statement. Always talk about what the evidence will show. Don't lose that opportunity. It's your first opportunity, it's your first impression with the judge. Give an opening statement. Don't waive it. The beauty of general district court too is usually the trial is 1 to 2 hours and you get a decision after the trial's over. The judge will rule from the bench. I've only had one time in Palmyra, Virginia, a long time ago, when a judge actually wanted to write an opinion and emailed it to us on Christmas Eve. It was bizarre. But usually, you don't have to wait that long. And usually, well, it was a nice Christmas Eve present, as it turned out, but usually you don't have to wait. And then, as in the materials here, there's a right to appeal. If the plaintiff gets a verdict in general district court and the defense appeals, then to circuit court, there's an appeal of right. There's nothing that the plaintiff could do in that case, and frankly, there's nothing the defendant can do if the plaintiff wants to appeal. But if the defendant appeals, then those affidavits that came in general district court shall come in circuit court. So it obviates the need for an expert. So you can use your affidavits, hand them to a jury, and say these are sworn statements of doctors, and there's nothing that anyone can do about that. That's statutory. So that's another advantage on appeal. You don't have to bring your doctor. That doesn't mean you shouldn't or you don't, but I mean, you need to make that decision, but you've got that affidavit. You get medical evidence that's going to come in through those affidavits in circuit court. All right, so we're in circuit court. This is not an appeal from general district court. Let's talk about from the beginning. From the beginning, we have our outline of proof. We know what we need to show. I would encourage you to begin, when you do that, looking at the jury instructions that you're going to be using. The jury instructions are statements of the law. And they will show you, and then those are what the judge will tell the jury before they retire. So, I mean, figure out what jury instructions you think you're going to need, and that will help you with your outline of proof and what you need to prove. Think about motions in limine. Motions in limine. Motions prior to trial. Motions to avoid problems at trial. So if you believe that an expert's going to say something you don't want him to say or is not allowed to say, move in limine to exclude that testimony. You know what he said in his deposition, you know what she's going to say. You don't like it, it's going to be hearsay, it's going to be something else. Move in limine in advance so that you're not in the middle of trial trying to deal with this in front of a jury and may we approach and then the jury's wondering what's going on. A lot of times you can avoid these major issues prior to trial. Make sure you know in your whatever court you're in what they require in terms of how far in advance you need to make these motions, because some don't want to hear these on the morning of trial. Some judges will say, I'm not going to hear that. This should have been brought on 2 weeks ago. So be familiar with Rule 415. That's the motions practice rule of the Supreme Court of Virginia. That talks about 2 weeks for the brief in support of a motion and 7 days for brief in opposition to the motion. Some judges are real sticklers for that rule. So just know what court you're in. You know, Fairfax has its unique procedures. Other courts have their own local rules where they like things done a certain way. Take the time to look at that so you don't tick the judge off and end up not getting your motion heard. But think about motions in limine in advance. Then we've got, once we get there to trial, we've got voir dire. Voir dire, there's an article in your materials that I wrote, I think, a couple of years ago. Voir dire is to see, to say in French. And it's your opportunity, your very first opportunity to talk to the jury. So you're going to have, in many cases, a jury panel, which comes in, and it's going to be a number, 30, 25, however many there are, depending on the jurisdiction. And usually, you get to talk to all of them at once. Sometimes they'll put, seven in a box, and then if someone, gets taken out, then they put someone else in. But usually, you get a chance to talk to everybody. So they come in and sit, on the benches where people who are watching the trial would sit. And you get to ask them questions. Take advantage of this opportunity, whether you're the plaintiff or the defendant, because this is your first time and only time, frankly, that you were able to interact with the jury. You'll be talking at the jury later, but now's an opportunity to talk to the jury, talk with the jury. And it's your opportunity to win them over. I think that it's very important in voir dire to know what your judges will allow you to do. Some judges do not want hours of voir dire. It'll depend on the case, the complexity of the case. I mean, we've had voir dire last day, more. But sometimes it can last just, an hour or so in the morning. But some judges don't want you there questioning the jury for hours. Make sure you ask. Ask about who, make sure you know what judge you're going to be in front of, and ask about what the judge, if anybody knows what the judge likes. The YLC is a great opportunity to do that. There, you can send emails to your colleagues, send emails to people you know, people who are doing this, people who practice in that area. Use your resources and figure out who the judge is and what they'll let you do on voir dire. Most judges will let you have a lot of leeway. It's important to quote unquote try your case in voir dire. This is your chance to make your first impression. It's your chance to sort of sell your case. You be careful. You're not going to be arguing anything. You're not going to be making arguments to the jury or the venire panel. But what you do want to do is make them familiar with the facts and make them familiar with your side of the facts. Does that make sense? And we've got the article here, this deceit to say there's several statutory, I don't know that we need to go through this, but there's several statutory ways that jurors can be excluded. And that's the relationship to either party, whether anybody has an interest in the case at the end of the day, and whether anyone's expressed an opinion in advance, and whether anybody is sensible of bias or prejudice. I would encourage you to look at the case of Lester versus Allied Concrete, which came out last year. I was actually just talking to Chris about this because there are two important areas where that case is important. One is in the social media context. That case involved a lawyer who told his client to delete Facebook posts. It was wrongful death. I was in this case. I was on brief in the Supreme Court. But this lawyer, who is now no longer a lawyer, told his client to delete Facebook. He had I Heart Hot Moms, and it was a wrongful death case for his wife, who had died, which was crushed by a cement truck. And so ultimately, the defense got all of that material. They got the posts, they got the email telling him to delete it, they got everything, and the jury still returned a $10 million verdict. And the defense appealed, and the Supreme Court ruled that the verdict should stand, and that the sanctions, the lawyer was heavily sanctioned and lost his license. But in that case, even for purposes of this talk, there was also a motion to exclude a juror because the juror was on a board, Meals on Wheels, in Charlottesville. It's a company that takes meals from restaurants and delivers them. They're not affiliated with a restaurant, they're a separate thing. They're like a taxi service for dinners. And they were a sponsor of the firm. And so there was allegations that the lawyer knew that this person was on the board and that that entity gave money to the firm. And that juror was on the panel, the ultimate final panel. And the Supreme Court ruled that was not sufficient to have excluded that juror. Look that case up. It's important for a lot of reasons. But that's a good example of an attempt to try to get a juror stricken for cause, even after the fact. Stricken for cause would mean one of these statutes, one of these statutory categories. So if it's my brother on the binary panel, he's going to get stricken for cause. I mean, it's not going to be an election later. I mean, if it's my mom, you know, my wife, whatever, they're stricken for cause. They have an interest in the case. They're related to me. They're related to, you know, the party, whatever. Otherwise, after that, you're striking these cases, striking these binary panel down to seven. After you each get three strikes, you really don't have to explain. As long as it's not racial or sexist, you don't have to explain why. You just don't like it. Or you don't get a good feeling about it, whatever. Obviously, a Batson challenge would be something like striking jurors for race and for no other purpose. Okay, so we've got our jury. We've got seven. And they're in the box. And again, we've got an opening statement. In your opening statement, it's not argument. You're not making arguments now. You're talking about what the facts will show. You want to highlight the facts that are important to you, and you want to address the facts that are harmful to you. Don't hide facts. They're going to come out. Be the first one to talk about your bad facts. If you're in trial, both sides have bad facts. Otherwise, the case is settled and you're sitting at home. So both sides have bad facts. Make sure you address the bad facts. Be the first one to talk about why these facts are not as important or why they should think about the facts a certain way. Don't ignore them. They'll come back to you later. Be accurate. Don't exaggerate what the facts will show. Don't exaggerate what the testimony will be. Keep it real, if you know what I mean. The jury is not, they're not stupid. They're going to go back there, and this is a beauty contest. I mean, they're going to watch every single thing you do when you're up there. Whether you're questioning a witness or you're delivering an opening statement, they're going to watch you. So don't exaggerate. Keep it real, and focus on the facts. I would also encourage you to use a style of narrating a story. Make it interesting. I mean, they don't want to be there. They're missing work. It's early in the morning. You know, they got a kid to pick up at 3 o'clock, whatever. They don't want to be there. Make it interesting. You know, you can even use a little humor. Make it compelling. You know, but I would encourage you, think of it like when you read your favorite novel, you read your favorite story. Make it sound like that. Take your time and do a good job. Make it interesting. Once we've got opening statements, we begin to have the plaintiff's evidence. Right? So, plaintiffs, that's what I do. I do plaintiffs' work. I represent plaintiffs exclusively. And that's all I've ever done. When you think that this is equally true for the defense, I mean, this all applies the same way. When you're getting up to put on your case in chief, for the plaintiff it would be first, and then the defense is the second. And the plaintiff gets a chance to rebuttal evidence, if there is any. Think about your order of witnesses. This is where your outline of proof comes into play. You already know how it's going to go. You've got the chapters, you've got the table of contents, you know how it's going to go. I hate surprises. I really do. And I hate surprises even more at trial. So when you have your outline of proof, and then you've got think about your order of witnesses. How do you want them to come in? Do you want your plaintiff first? Do you want your plaintiff last? Usually I like to put the plaintiff on last, because it's the last thing the jury hears before I arrest my case. Often, you think, well, then, you know, if we just think about a PI case, like a car crash case, imagine that. You want the officer to testify? We know that the accident report doesn't come in. It can't come in. But the officer can testify about what the officer saw, you know, what the officer did. So, do you want the officer to come and sort of set the stage? You know, talk about the intersection, talk about the lights there, talk about, you know, the damage to the vehicles. Set the stage that way. Or do you want to go with damages first? Do you want your doctor to come on and testify about what happened? Talk about the injuries, talk about the treatment. In a Med-Mal case, you know, do you want your doctor to come on first and talk about what happened? What's the medicine? How did the operation go wrong? Why are we here? Do we want to do that? We want the plaintiff to come on first and explain, think about it, because it will be different for every case. Most of the time, you want, the jury is most interested in the very beginning, right? It's exciting, opening statement, there's drama, we're in a courtroom, So the first witness is important. The middle witnesses can get lost, but the last witness before resting, and I usually make it a point to that this is our last witness, because then the jury, okay, good, so what are we gonna hear? If they're not already asleep, hopefully they're not. Then, the last witness is also important, because that's what they hear last. So think about your order of proof. Do you want to call the opposing party as an adverse witness? Do you think that the defendant has something to say? You can treat him as a hostile witness, right? And you can cross-examine him almost in your case in chief. Think about that. If you're the defense, do you want to call the plaintiff? Did the plaintiff say something harmful and you didn't get it out of cross-examination of the plaintiff? Think about calling the adverse witness, the opposing party. All right, cross-examination. Well, and I guess we should talk about this a little bit more, but in direct examination, the idea is we want to bring out the facts. And again, you don't hide from bad facts. You want to go ahead and address the bad facts. So you want to humanize your client. People are skeptical of anybody in court. They are. Especially skeptical of plaintiffs. It's a litigious society. You don't like it. Lots of lawsuits. People getting too much money. People are looking to win the lottery. And then defendants are sitting there and they're not saying a whole lot. Who's that guy? What did he do? What's he here for? They're skeptical of us. What are we doing? Lawyers. You don't like lawyers until they need one. You want to humanize your client. And that's why I think voir dire is so important. You can humanize yourself too during voir dire. You can show that you're a real person, you care about the case, you're here for this reason. This is a unique case. This is not every case. This is not the $3 billion NFL lawsuit. This is our case. This is here today, just us. And when you do it on direct examination of your client, you want to make sure that the jury sees them as human beings. Where are you from? Do you have any family in the area? How old are you? Married? Where'd you go to school? If the guy's a police officer, you want to bring it out. If the guy's a dentist or school teacher, whatever the person does, make sure that the jury knows that they're just like him or just like her. It helps, it will help you go a long way. Otherwise, people are skeptical anyway, they don't want to be here, and I think that gives you a real advantage. And I think a lot of people don't spend enough time doing that. I think a lot of people launch right into the questions about the case. We're talking now about the med mal, we're talking now about the personal injury, we don't know who you are. Remember, the jury doesn't know what you know. The jury doesn't know anything. The jury's sitting there hearing this for the first time. So make your client human. On cross-examination, I see so often lawyers really screw up cross-examination. Never, never ask an open-ended question on cross-examination. Never. Do not. Do not say, so where were you? How do you know about that? You're going to get slammed. You're going to give them a chance to wiggle and make up whatever they want to make up. They've said what they've said on direct examination. Hopefully you've taken their deposition prior to being here, so you know what they've said. Depositions are under oath. Use depositions in cross-examination. That's your best weapon. Because people don't say the same thing twice. They'll say it a little different. They'll say it, they forgot, or they made it up. Whatever, but people say different things. It's hard to keep track of a story. It's hard to keep track of what you said, even if you're telling the truth. So cross-examination, never, never use open-ended questions. Use one-fact leading questions only. It was dark. It was 10 o'clock. The light was red. You were wearing a yellow shirt. Statements. You don't need to ask questions like, well, isn't it true? You don't need this. Isn't it true that you were there that night? You can just say you were there that night. You were wearing a red shirt. You were drunk. Whatever. But that kind of thing, control the witness. Don't give the witness any room to wiggle. Because the witness will wiggle. And this happens a lot with expert doctors. They love to talk. My dad's a doctor. He loves to talk. But they love it. When they get a chance to get up there and give their opinion, they're the smartest person on the planet. Many of these guys have done it plenty of times, and they know what they're doing, and they're very good at it. Those of you who do this know. These docs, they dig it, man. They get paid a lot of money, and they get to be hotshot, all-star. The jury likes these doctors because they're real smart, and they sound interesting, and they use funny words, and whatever. So these docs, you got to make sure you don't let them do that. They'll do all that on direct examination, but what you get on cross-examination, I would first of all do my research. I'm talking now just about expert doctors. Do your research on these doctors. Chances are they've testified more than 10 times. lot of these people do it, and they make a lot of money doing it. So see if, use the YLC, use your network, use whoever you have, see if you can get some transcripts of testimony these doctors have testified before. Because they'll talk about how much money they make doing this. You know, oh yeah, last year $200,000 in forensic legal work. That's right, that's what I made. You know, and then the jury hears that, and they're like, you know, and you can use that to your advantage. This guy's a hired gun. Made $200,000 last year just in forensics. What's he doing? Is he treating patients? Is he golfing a lot? What's he doing? So, I mean, you can find this information, and you can use it, and I encourage you to do that. Get as much information as you can about these doctors before. Always take their deposition before, too. Always do that. But you can look for this kind of information to impeach them and impeach their credibility. If the jury thinks that they're hired guns, are they going to give them as much, you know, whatever, benefit of the doubt as they are the treating doctor who's here? Sure, he's getting paid, but he's here because this is his patient. I mean, think about that. Cross-examination, though, one fact leading questions only. Don't ask compound questions like, wasn't it true it was dark and it was 10 o'clock? Isn't it true you were at the intersection of 1st and 15th and you were wearing a red jersey? Keep it to one fact. Lead them down. I just thought of this, but there's a phrase. It's by a famous older lawyer, and I can't remember who it is, but it says, cross-examination should be like leading them down a path very, very precisely and then slitting their throat at the end. You want to do that. Think about it. Set it up so that you can set them up. They think they know what they're doing. These witnesses, even if you're just doing the defendant or you're doing some of, you know, the plaintiff, you know, they've thought this through. I mean, they're people are people. And you know how it is when you're under a spotlight. It's not comfortable, you know, and you say things. So know what they're going to say. Never open any questions. Don't ask questions you don't know the answer to. We all know that, right? I mean, again, deal with bad facts. So if you've got bad facts, go ahead and deal with them on cross-examination if they haven't been brought out yet. Because the other side will have a chance to come up for redirect. Remember that. So you've got direct examination. The other side has an opportunity to cross-examine you. And then the other side gets to come back up and redirect if there's new evidence. So go ahead and get it out of the way. I mean, if you're in cross-examination, take that opportunity to get what you need, then get out. Don't spend time rehashing. Another thing that I see all the time is the opposing counsel rehashing the testimony of the witness. So you testified on direct that it was a red light, didn't you? We all know that already. She already said that. You know, when you told me on direct that you had pork and beans that night, we already heard all that. I mean, we don't need to rehash it all. Okay. And sometimes they do it on damning evidence. So I mean, things that are bad. Well, you testified that the plaintiff was drunk, right? I mean, why are we doing that? I mean, don't. I mean, you need to go get to what you need and get out of there, you know? Focus on the stuff that you need and then get out. Use your depositions. I think that's very important. Another thing that I will strongly encourage you on cross-examination or at all in trial, try with all your might to avoid appealing to the judge for help. Don't look to the judge and say, Your Honor, the witness isn't. Don't do that. The jury's watching you. The jury wants you to be in control. The jury wants to know that you're in charge of the room. That's why we're taught you want to articulate, project. You're in charge. This is court. We're in trial. You want to do that. Don't look to the judge for help. If the witness is squirming or the witness doesn't, figure it out. Figure it out. Don't look to the judge. Many times the judge will be like, it's your witness. Even if you do that, you know, or the judge will answer the question. You know, I mean, but you've just let yourself look weak. You've just let yourself look like you can't control the courtroom in front of the jury. And believe me, that's important. The jury needs to believe that you know what you're doing and that you're in charge and that you've got control of the witness. So I find that to be a very common mistake to look to the judge when the witness is being difficult. You're going to get these difficult witnesses, but if you get these nice, short, one fact leading questions, you've got deposition testimony to back it up. It's hard for them to squirm because you can go straight to the deposition and say, well, you know, it's funny. Remember when I took your deposition back in May? Remember that? You came to my office. Remember we had a court reporter. Your lawyer was there. Remember that? It was sunny that day. Well, listen, you know, when I was asking you questions on that day, remember you were under oath. You were sworn under oath. Remember that? Yeah, well, so I asked you back then, was the sweater red? And you told me it was red. But do you remember that? You remember telling me it was red? I don't know. I don't know if I said that. Well, now I've got a trial.
I'd like to show you your deposition transcript. This is us looking at your deposition transcript in May. You just look at lines 7 through 12 on page 5. Was your testimony read? Well, if that's what it says.
Right. So here today, you decided it was white. What is it? Red or white? Red or white both times. Creates an awkward situation. Use depositions because credibility of the witness, they're looking for lies. And juries love cross-examination, right? It's sexy. It's the time when someone's going to come in and they're gonna get them. You know, they're going to get the lies. You see it, you know, and on Law and Order, when he gets up there and says, "You weren't there, were you?" And everyone's like, "Yeah." That's a highlight. I mean, it's a real moment in the trial. He was waiting for cross-examination, you know. The guy's just testified. He's like, slam dunk, he won. And then cross-examination comes, and the jury's like, "Oh, boy." And you get to have it. Now's your chance. Kill him. Use depositions. All right. Does anybody have any questions so far? I don't even know what time it is. Okay. So I've got a half an hour still. Oh, so we'll have time for questions and discussion, if you like. Yeah?
I have a quick question about the jury. How do you feel about doing any pre-voir dire research?
Excellent point. Always do it. So, we were talking about social media earlier. Thanks for bringing this up. It's actually in my outline. I missed it. So, before you get, you're allowed to get the venire panel list from the court prior to trial. They have to give it to you. I think it's 48 hours before trial. Maybe it's 3 days. But they have to give it to you. They have to fax it to you if you request it. So you call the clerk's office and you ask for a list of the venire panel. That list will show you how old they are, often where they work, and their home address. Now, use common sense when you're doing this, okay? But you are allowed to research these people. Social media. Look up every single venire panel on Facebook. Look them up on Twitter. Look them up on Tumblr, Instagram. Google them. Find out what you know about them. You can find out their political affiliations often. You can find out where they work if that's not listed. People are out there. You can find them. And you can find out bumper stickers. You can find out, you know, "I hate tort law" guy, you know, and you don't want him on your panel if you're playing this for it, you know, or "I love defense verdicts." I mean, then I don't want him on my jury. So that's it. This is a good point. Now, there's some lawyers that I know who will actually go and look at the property where the person on the venire panel lives. Obviously, this is fraught with peril. You want to be very careful about this. If you do not want to talk to any of these people, you don't want to communicate with these people, you don't want to be accused of tampering with the venire, you're opening up a whole can of ethical worms. Or a whole ethical worms. Worms are ethical, I suppose. So be careful with your research. Don't try to friend these people. Don't try to, you know, tweet at them like, "Look, hook me up. You know, I really need a sweet birdie. It's a rough month for me." I mean, don't do anything like that. Okay? To look these people up, just like they can look you up. Right? Clients Google us. Lawyers Google us. Don't you Google the other lawyer on the other side? Don't you always go to the webpage and look him up? Look where she went to law school, you know, or, you know, whatever, what she does, or, I mean, we all do that. I mean, you do that before you go on a date, right? Don't you Google the other person? People Google people. So, I mean, it makes sense to do the research, to look these people up, and don't contact them. Do not. But if you can look at public information or whatever is available to anybody else who wants to look, look them up. Okay, and then we might as well stick with voir dire for a minute. This is just another technique. But once you have that, I always create a table, like a grid, where I've got the number. So everybody's got a number, and they're only going to be referred to by number. So if you can hire, you know, juror number 35, juror number 3, you won't use their names. Okay, so they'll all have a number, then they'll have, in my grid, I put a number, and then I put their name, and I put whatever information I know about them, and then I've got an empty box. And that way, the empty box is to write in whatever I learn when I'm asking. You know, because questions like, you know, who thinks there are too many lawsuits? Who thinks there are just way too many lawsuits? You know, and then you get some hands. And then you say, well, why? Why do you think that? You know, and then at the end of the day, you ask the question, well, do you think that would compromise your ability to sit here and listen to the evidence and produce a fair verdict for both parties?
And if they say no, then they're probably okay. If they say yes, we've got a problem. I mean, we need to talk to the judge now because you're going to get stricken for cause. But if they say no, I mean, this is where you get this chance to get this information and write it down in that little box. Because you've got to make some quick decisions. Once you've asked all these questions, the voir dire is over. The judge is going to instruct the jury with the preliminary instruction while you're doing your strikes. And you're sitting there, and you don't have a whole lot of time. I mean, you feel like you need to move it along. And so you want to have this information in front of you. Always ask your client what they think. Always have a notebook with a pen for your client who's sitting next to you. Because the client sees things. The client's human. The client knows any of these people, I mean, or has heard about any of these people. You want to know that, because that creates problems potentially. So that's a good point, to do the research in advance, and that will give you a bit of a leg up. Some people you can't find. I mean, especially if you're in a place like, it's very rural and people are all spread out everywhere, you can't find it. You can't find as much information. But if you're up here in Northern Virginia, I mean, the people are we're pretty all concentrated. You can find people. All right, so then, any other questions? Yeah?
I have a question about your philosophy on voir dire when it comes to referencing other, like, highly publicized cases. So, to the extent that you, if your facts are similar, or if one aspect of your proof is similar, referencing something that's been recently in the media, or even not recently, like, you know, asking them if they've heard about the woman who sued McDonald's for hot coffee or something like that.
Sure, absolutely. I have done that, and I would do that. And so, like, when I have a brain injury case, for example, asking about, well, what do people feel about the NFL? What do people feel about concussions and head injuries? Because that's become a hot topic now. People are talking about head injuries and kids, you know, Pee Wee football and soccer. I mean, the people are suing the MLS, or this Major League Soccer, for concussions and brain injuries that have happened there. I absolutely would, because I think those things are so dominant in the media that people have opinions on these things. People have opinions not only on lawsuits, but on class actions and head injury. I mean, brain injury would be one area where I would do that, because brain injuries are very difficult to understand. People look normal. They look like nothing's wrong with them. And they're experiencing problems nevertheless. And there's not a lot of objective evidence in these brain injury cases. There could be some neuropsyche valves, but those are harder cases because the people look, there's no scar, they're fine, they're standing here, they're sitting here, they look okay. So to bring out something like that, when you feel like you could face a prejudice coming in, I would definitely do that. Hot coffee is a good example, too. Everyone know about this case, McDonald's case? Anyway, I would encourage you to watch the movie called Hot Coffee. Does anybody know of that? It's a documentary on the case, because it did not go down the way the media presented it. That verdict was pared down. The woman was terribly injured. And, you know, whenever I hear this, by the way, as a quick aside, whenever I hear this about, you know, well, $50 million for hot coffee or whatever it was, the fact is, a jury decided that. A jury decided that. Not a judge, not the plaintiff. A jury. That's our system. Anyway, look up Hot Coffee, no matter what area of practice. Very interesting documentary. I think it's only an hour. It might be on PBS or something. It's probably available on YouTube. Anything else? Good questions. Okay, so we're up to summation, closing argument, right? The evidence has been presented, so that the plaintiff puts on the plaintiff's evidence, and then the defense can make a motion to strike the evidence, saying you haven't yet met your burden, you haven't proved the fundamental elements of your case, you haven't made a prima facie case, so we don't even have to put on a defense, we win. And if you haven't, we want your outline of proof, of course, if you haven't met your burden, if you haven't proved the elements of the tort, you're going to get your case kicked out. The defense won't even have to put on evidence. So make sure that you, when you do your outline of proof, obviously, that you're going to meet all the elements of your tort so that you don't get kicked out on a motion to strike. Defense goes, defense does the same thing, puts on the defendant, puts on an expert, puts on, you know, fact witnesses about how great the defendant is or whatever, and do the same thing the plaintiff tried to do. And then there can be a motion for summary judgment. A motion for summary judgment can come at any time. Virginia's state court does not like summary judgment. The Supreme Court of Virginia does not like summary judgment. That doesn't mean that it can't happen, but they don't like it. It's disfavored. They usually want, the court's been pretty clear, that they want these cases tried by a jury. They want a jury verdict. They don't want to take it away from the jury. And short circuit is the language that you short circuit the case. In summary judgment motions in Virginia, you cannot use deposition testimony. And the most powerful thing to use in a motion for summary judgment is requests for admission.
requests for admission are a discovery tool, which you may know about, which are asking the other side to admit or deny certain facts as it relates to the case. And usually, I always do requests for admission because it narrows the issues for trial. So if we can agree on a lot of things, and I know you're admitting these things, then I know that I don't need to, we can read that in evidence or we can do something else, but we now know what the issues are for trial. So request for admission can be used in summary judgment motion, but those are very, very rare. I mean, summary judgment obviously means there's no dispute about the material facts and we win as a matter of law. We don't need to go to a jury. So don't expect to see summary judgment very often. In summation and closing argument, now is your chance to argue. It's your last chance to talk to the jury. If you're a talk at the jury, which is basically what you've been doing since you are here, you want to use the jury instructions. The judge will have already instructed the jury. You want to use the jury instructions and use those to your advantage. Why these jury instructions, how they should interpret these jury instructions. You're going to take the jury instructions back into the deliberation room, and then it's who knows what goes on back there. I mean, I'm even not guessing what goes on back there. I mean, the conversations they have, the reasons that they decide these things, sometimes it's hard to understand. But I mean, we're jaded, we're lawyers, we're brainwashed, we're destroyed, we're not normal anymore. And so, you know, it's hard to think like, you know, normal people. But use the jury instructions. Tell them when they go back there, here's what you do with this, okay? This is jury instruction number 9.000, damages instruction. Here's what the plaintiff's entitled to. X, Y, Z, this, and this, and this. If, in fact, the case is Wackel versus Barber, which was Ed's case, by the way, I wrote the amicus brief on that for BTLA, which says now, if you're a plaintiff's lawyer, you can write in an amount that is being asked for at each of the sections of damages. So for, you know, medical bills, for pain and suffering, humiliation, inconvenience, blah, 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 you can actually write that in now. I would encourage you to think about that. Many times during summation, people will have a blow-up of a jury instruction, just as in a demonstrative evidence. And it's not evidence, it's a demonstrative exhibit. It's just something for them to see. Because, I mean, you can walk up and hold the jury instruction out like this, but if they can see it, you can follow along. Here's what this says. Here's what the law is. The judge told you this is the law. And you've all sworn an oath to follow the law. This is what the law is. This is why you interpret it the way I want you to. And that's it can be a very powerful tool. I would encourage you to think about using demonstrative exhibits. You know, if there's some kind of aerial view of a crash scene, I mean, put it up there. Let people see it. People want to see things. That's why my presentation today probably is terrible, because I don't have anything to look at. I mean, if I had a demonstrative exhibit, people wouldn't be snoring. I mean, it's a good way to visually, you know, to get people engaged and get people involved and people paying attention, especially the jury instructions. Use the jury instructions. Both sides will try to use the same jury instructions, no doubt, and try to tell you why their side of the story should be applied the way they want it to these jury instructions. But use the jury instructions. It's funny because at the beginning, I was telling you use the jury instructions to work on your outline of proof. But this is where we are now. Now the instructions are what governs the case. Uh-huh. So we want to do that. Also, maybe I should step back. Jury instructions are. You know, you have to exchange them prior to trial, just a couple of days prior to trial. And then most of the time, they can be agreed upon. The parties can agree on which jury instructions are going to be used. And there's Virginia Model Jury Instructions, DMJI. It's a book where most of the jury instructions that are used are found. Sometimes, if there's a complicated issue of law or a unique issue, there can be a case that you cite for proposition of a jury instruction, and usually there'll be a fight about that. But that usually can be worked out while the jury's at lunch or on a break. You go up and fight about a couple of different jury instructions. The judge will rule. Always make sure those arguments are on the record. You want a court reporter. Make sure that when you approach the bench, you allow the court reporter to come up and take down what you're talking about. Many times, it's easy to forget when you approach, because the court reporter is taking out everything you say, but they can hear everything you say. You approach the bench. Some judges have a little noise machine they put on so the jury can't hear what you're saying for obvious reasons. But when you get up there, insist that the court reporter be there with you. Because a lot of times in these little meetings up at the bench, major decisions happen. And you want a record. Because if you go up to the Supreme Court and there is no record of what you're talking about, you're saying the defense lawyer said this, and the judge ruled this, but there's no record of that. What do you do? The Supreme Court has said there's no record. How can we rule on it? So So make sure that everything that you say, even if you approach the bench or even if you're in chambers talking to the judge, unless the judge obviously says that that's not in here, I would still strongly insist, gently, that the court reporter be there with you, that you want to make a record. And if things are excluded, I'm going a little random now, but I'm thinking of some things. So, and if evidence is excluded, with respect to the court reporter, make sure that you proffer what the evidence would have been on the record. So if you want an expert to testify that, you know, took off the left arm instead of the right arm, and, you know, there was gangrene and a guy almost died, and the judge said, I'm not letting any of that in, for whatever reason, but you want that testimony in, that's your part of your case, then when the jury's out, proffer that evidence. Say, I just would like to make a proffer, and I want to tell the court what the evidence would have shown that has been excluded. So the court reporter can take it down and say, I have a record. If the evidence is excluded, and we don't ever know what the evidence would have been, only I know that, and only my expert knows that, the Supreme Court's not going to know that. If that's error, if the trial judge should have let that testimony in, I don't have a record of that anymore. So make a proffer. The judge will let you make a proffer, and just that's what you say. And then you say whatever it is the evidence would have been, and now you have a record. So if you decide to appeal because that's error, you've got evidence of that ruling. Okay, so back to summation. Use the jury instructions. Sum up what the evidence was. Don't you know, go through witness by witness with every single thing that everybody said, but make sure that you accentuate the most important evidence to your case. Deal with the bad facts again. Talk about why those bad facts are okay, or why they're not as bad as the other side wants you to believe. Sum it up. Go through the evidence. Some of these cases, these trials have gone on for weeks. I mean, it's going to be a long closing argument. And you need to make sure they don't forget about the witness who testified on day one, now that we're 3 weeks deep in the trial. So you want to make sure that you remind them of the very important facts that you were able to deduce from the witnesses at trial. Deal with the other side. The other side, the plaintiff goes first, then the defense, then the plaintiff gets a chance one more time for rebuttal. Make sure that you address the other side. You know what they're going to argue. You know what the other side's going to say. You've been hearing it for a year now, and you've heard it through the trial. Deal with it. Deal with it. Don't avoid it. Avoiding it can be very dangerous. This is your chance now to apply the law to the facts. So it's different from the opening statement because now you're talking about law. Now you're applying the law to the facts. You're arguing why the law supports your side of the story. That's where you're using the jury instructions. It's important. These are statements of law. So you can say, here are our facts, here's what the law is, this is why they go together, this is why we win. Now's your chance to argue. Careful with your tone and careful with extremes. In closing argument, it's easy to get heated. It's a long day, long week, long month. You're tired. Everybody's tired. The jury's tired. Remember that. The jury's tired. The jury is who you want. You need the jury. That's everything. So careful with your tone. It can be easy to get really hostile, really fired up, and really mad at you, pointing fingers and doing this. Defense counsel would have you believe that. Try to avoid that. I mean, unless the case calls for it, unless what you're trying to do is really get the jury mad, you know, so that they're really mad about what happened, and that's going to work to your favor. Many times, it makes much more sense to be calm, reasonable, you know, smile at them. You know, it's been a long day. You know, everybody's tired. Careful with your tone and don't use extremes. Just like we did with the opening statement, don't make up evidence. If evidence didn't come in, you wish it did. Don't try to testify, okay? You're gonna draw an objection and you're gonna get scolded and they'll move to strike that. So don't talk about things that didn't come in. Talk about only what really happened, but make it as favorable to your point as possible, your side. Stick to the evidence. Right, so that would be the same thing. Stick to only what came in. Don't stick to what you wish had come in or talk about that. Talk about what really happened and then explain why you should win. After, then, you know, the jury will retire, obviously. The jury gets back. There's no time limit on how long a jury can deliberate. The jury many times, almost always, in my experience, will have some kind of a question. And what they do is they write down, they elect a foreperson, as you know, and then they'll write down a question, and they'll pass it to the bailiff, who will bring it to the judge. And the judge, you know, if the lawyers are sitting outside or
pound of coffee or whatever they're doing waiting for the jury, sit in a witness room, call the lawyers back in, we all go back in, make sure the court reporter is there. You want everything on the record. It's got to be on the record. So wait for the court reporter to come in. Jury asks a question. How do we calculate interest? Question like that. Or can we see the police report? Or, you know, are we allowed to not believe one of the witnesses? I mean, they get all kinds of questions. Most of them haven't done this before. And we know what we're doing, but the jury, you know, is trying to figure it out. And in their thought process, I'll talk a little bit more about that in a minute. It's fascinating. So if they have a question, then we get to talk about how we should answer the question. So the judge doesn't just decide how the question is answered. We get to input, you know, here's what we say. And usually there can be agreement on how to answer the question. But if there isn't, you want that on the record, and you want to object if the answer that you don't want is being given. Make sure, because you want to be able to preserve that in case it's error. Then the jury will come back with a verdict. They'll be asked if they've reached a verdict. Yes, we have. Hand it up, judge. They read it. And then I always poll the jury. You poll the jury, which means you tell the judge, I'd like to poll the jury. And then the judge will ask each juror individually, is this your verdict? And there was one time, I think it was in Charlottesville, that I had a jury trial, and one of the jurors said, that's not my verdict. And you have to have a unanimous verdict. But some people feel pressured. You know, you get in there, you get the quiet one, the one who doesn't want to ruffle any feathers, doesn't want to be there. You know, the poor person is usually the one who's take charge. Here's how we're going to talk about things. I think we should do this, and this is how we should figure it out. Sometimes there are people who aren't, this isn't their personality. Like, they're not the take charge type. They're there, and they're just trying to do the right thing. And they feel pressure to make a decision a certain way. Oh, yeah.
Do you ask that question of the verdict was in your favor or only when you lost the case?
So, but poll the jury because who knows what went on in that room and who knows what they're thinking sitting there. And if somebody just wants to go home and just wants to get out of here and whatever, okay, whatever you guys decide is cool, but you don't really like it, in your gut you feel like it's wrong, maybe somebody will say it's not my verdict. And obviously it needs to be unanimous. It's not, it's a mistrial. Sorry, word. I always contact jurors after the trial. You are allowed to do this. They are not required to talk to you. Make sure that they know that you're just the lawyer trying to work on your ability, trying to work on how you present your cases, and you just would love some feedback about what you thought, like how the trial went, and what did you find effective or not effective, and how did you guys reach your verdict. A lot of times they won't talk to you because they're done with lawyers and they're done with court. They've had just about enough of you. But sometimes they will. Now, I've talked to many jurors who say, you know, well, you know, we really thought that this exhibit was very helpful, or we didn't believe your client, or, you know, that I really would have loved to hear more about this, or it just didn't seem fair that this, I mean, and it's not legal analysis. And they're finders of fact. I mean, they're there to determine what the facts are, right? They're the fact finder. The judge is the law. They're the facts. So they're dealing with that. And how they think about the facts and what they think is important is fascinating. I had a case in Spotsylvania County where a woman was mauled by pit bulls and died. Her name was Dorothy Sullivan. And now, you know all these dangerous dog laws that have been passed where you've got to register vicious dogs, dangerous dogs? Vicious dogs that have to be put down. Dangerous dogs have to be registered. There's a list of these things, and there are certain requirements, statutory, as a result of Ms. Sullivan's death. So we sued the Department of Animal Control because the owner of the dog was actually convicted of manslaughter, and the Court of Appeals upheld that conviction. First time ever for a dog-related offense. The woman was convicted of manslaughter, and it was upheld on appeal. She didn't have any money, there was nothing. She lived in a trailer, I think. It was just a really bad situation where she was for a lot of reasons that are not important. But we needed to find someone to hold responsible for this. And what we found out is that the Department of Animal Control had received, I believe, 17 different complaints about these dogs attacking people, killing a German Shepherd next door to this house, numerous attacks running through. They were unneutered, they were running in packs, and they weren't being controlled. And so they had been very dangerous for a long period of time.
So we sued the Department of Animal Control, these people who had, you know, responded. We also had evidence that when they responded, they just drove through and left. They never got out, and they never investigated these kinds of things. There were all of these different facts. And I'm being loose with the facts just for purposes of the illustration of how juries decide verdict. So we're suing a government agency, right? So we've got sovereign immunity problems. We've got to plead out from under the Virginia Tort Claims Act, which limits recovery to $100,000 for ordinary negligence. But if you prove gross negligence, there's no cap unless it's medical malpractice, which is $2 million. So we sued for her death, and we got past a demur, which is, as you probably know in Virginia, like a 12B6 motion, motion dismissed, you haven't stated a claim. Got past that. We got past the motion for summary judgment, which also, you know, was hotly contested. And we got to the jury. The jury returned a defense verdict. And we appealed. We were not granted the writ on appeal. But we found out from the jury, the way that they had decided the case was they had gotten a white piece of paper, and they had drawn a line on that paper. And they had decided that the gross negligence was above the line, and ordinary negligence was below the line. And then they looked at the various things that we had alleged that the Department of Animal Control officers had done, and they weighed it. So they put a few here, and a few here, and a few here, and they decided the majority were below the line, so defense verdict, not gross negligence. Yeah.
Yeah, a few years ago, I was working on a case of first-degree murder. One of the defenses that we brought was not guilty by reason of insanity. And I remember we didn't get the jury instruction that we wanted, and I polled the jury afterwards, and they didn't apply the right standard. And we didn't do anything with it because we ended up getting a good enough verdict, as it were. But do you think, or do you know, can you use some of the statements that the jury makes after the case as a basis for an appeal?
I don't think you probably can do that. Because I think the deliberation process is sacred. I don't think you can. In fact, in the Lester case that I mentioned earlier about the cement truck who crushed the woman and the Facebook post and all that, the juror, I think, who was accused of having this conflict of interest, wrote a letter to the editor of the newspaper saying it didn't have any effect at all. I didn't know that there was this relationship, or I didn't know that lawyer, or maybe I knew this relationship, I didn't know that lawyer, something like that. And then no one talked about that on appeal. So I would think not. I don't have any authority for that, but I would think not. Anyway, so the jury, you can learn from the jury. None of us is perfect. We all have our bad days. I mean, I have more bad days than good days, goodness knows. I mean, it can help you. I mean, because you're basically an actor. I mean, these are your the audience. You're being watched, everything you do. And so if you can learn how to do it better, you want to, right? I mean, that's some other lawyers. We're all destroyed, like I said. We're normal people. We're talking to normal people. We're not talking to lawyers. So anyway, I think, and then, you know, obviously there's appeal. We have an appellate process, and there's appeals directly to the Supreme Court of Virginia in civil cases, with the exception of domestic cases and workers' comp cases. Those can go to the Court of Appeals, but and criminal cases go to the Court of Appeals, but civil cases go straight to the Supreme Court of Virginia. And it's a writ system, as you may know, so they don't have to take your appeal. There's no appeal of right in civil cases. So you petition for appeal, and the process goes from there. And if anybody is interested in learning more about the appellate process, or writing amicus briefs or things like that, I'd be glad to talk to you. Or frankly, anything else about trial, if you like. Do we have any time left?
Yeah, you have 15 minutes left.
I talk so fast, like, way too much.
Wait. No, you have 2 minutes left.
Two. Nailed it. All right, well, yeah.
Any of your jurors that you hold, did they comment on attorney's appearance or how they made their decision?
Yep.
Because I've heard from a judge, and he only wears black shoes because when he was a trial lawyer, somebody told him he didn't like his brown shoes.
Yep, as simple as that. I had one tell me one time that they thought the defense lawyer came across badly, that he was rude. That wasn't me, unfortunately. I've never had anything bad said about me, but I suppose they'd say the bad things about me to the other lawyer. but I mean, that's so true. I mean, you are on stage. They're watching everything you do. If you bite your fingernails like I do, they're watching you. You know, if you're picking your nose or you're, you know, talking too loud to your client, I mean, they're watching you. And they it's very much a beauty contest, so be aware. And don't wear brown shoes. I made it today. Yeah.
Can you just follow up on that? How much of a beauty contest does kind of your gut tell you that it is? Or is it very, very, I mean, it's kind of, it's generally dangerous, but.
Yeah, no, I always watch the jury. So you can tell, I think you can tell, like, what, if you got the jury or not. Like, if the jury is sitting up, you know, like this, and looking at everything and nodding, you know, or smiling, or, I like that. Like, you're engaged. That means you're, we have had a juror fall asleep. I mean, you know, if the jury's sort of sitting back, or you hear the jury go, oh. I've heard this, and someone's testifying, and, you know, and they think it's just bunk, you know, and somebody just goes, you know, do this. I mean, it's really, I pay attention to the jury, because, you know, if you feel like you're losing the jury, you might want to figure out a way to re-engage them. But, you know, and especially if you say something and they go, you might as well rest your case. You know. What else you got? Yeah.
Question. How do you recover from a bad situation that you had?
What bad situation?
I don't know.
Any bad situation? Okay, so trials are super stressful, right? I mean, they're really hard, and it's really deflating to lose a trial, especially one that's gone on for days. You spent years on it and you lost. The way I move on from that is to remember that this is my job. It's important that I do my job, but this is my job, and I have other things that I enjoy. Like, I enjoy my girlfriend. I enjoy fishing. I enjoy going for a run. I enjoy going out to eat. Don't let this overwhelm you. I mean, and it's very easy to do. I mean, we all know, we went to law school, and it's just like all consuming, overwhelming. You feel like it's the only thing in your life. I would encourage you that it's not. This is a very important job that we have. We all have grave responsibilities in our jobs. But these are jobs. And I hope that all of you have things that you enjoy doing, not sitting in here, you know, or at least with me, or going to court, or, you know, getting scolded by a partner, or, you know, having a fight with defense counsel, or having an untrustworthy client. I mean, these are all parts of what we deal with every day. But the way I deal with it is I try to put it there. There's a line between my job and my life, my personal life. I'm not telling you that's always easy, because what we do is consuming. But if you can figure out a way to put a line between where you are at the office or court or whatever and where you are in life, I think that could go a long way to helping you recover from, because you're going to lose more than you're going to win. Right? We all know that. That's sort of part of life. I mean, you lose a lot. Savor it. And in other ways, to savor that win. When you get the good win, savor it. Celebrate it. But the same way, don't let the losses get to you. Did you have a question too? Or were you just telling me to shut up?
No question. I'm not telling you to shut up. We are at time.
Well, yeah. Okay. Good. Unless there's anything else, I can be here for a few more minutes and I've got to go to Charlotte's if anybody wants to ask anything about him. And get involved with YLC, it's a good opportunity.